Hello everyone, Andrew Wasson from CreativeGuitarStudio.com. On this video, I want to help you understand how a guitar solo would function if it were performed on just one string. Now, this idea came up when I had one of the students here in my studio ask me about the lead guitar line from the start of Coldplay's song Shiver. Now, that song has a single string melody kick in around 10 seconds or so, and it's a great example of how a lead guitar idea can be performed using only one guitar string, yet still be catchy and still be something that connects with the listener as a line that matters to the song it's used in. So in this lesson, we'll break down how to understand the key of your solo when played across one guitar string. We'll discuss how to pinpoint the tonic of the scale so that you understand the key center and it's clear to you on that guitar string. And we'll also study how to think more horizontally when you're composing or improvising your lead guitar parts. All right, so whether you're soloing on one guitar string or all the guitar strings in all the positions of the neck, the first step, regardless, is going to be understanding what's happening with the chord progression that you're dealing with. Now, you know, in most cases, when you're performing a guitar solo, you're beginning with determining the key signature, the key of the song that you're going to be jamming over. And this means you're going to need to be able to analyze the chord changes and to determine the tonic note or the root note of the key center, along with whether it's a major or a minor tonality chord progression. So this first step, even though it's universal, I'm going to be going over, you know, something that's really important, and that's probably 75% of the time, the first chord that you hear is basically going to be the key of the progression of the tune that you're working on. So in this case, I've put together this short chord progression traveling from D minor to A minor, and then B flat major into C major, and that's, you know, going to be our chord progression there. Now, because the very first chord that we heard there is D minor, that means that, in this case, anyway, this is a D minor chord progression. Now, it's not always going to be like this, but I'll tell you, probably 75% of the time, that first chord that you hear is going to be the chords of the key center. Now, if you analyze the chord changes on their movement strategy, this is really good to understand. I'm just going to run through this very quickly. We're thinking of the root of the key center, the D there, as being the first tone, and then the second tone is E, third is F, and then the fourth is G, the fifth is A, the sixth is B flat, and then the seventh is C. And so when you do the analysis of the chord changes, what you're looking for is, first of all, whether all those tones from the key are actually in the progression, and they are. You know, the root chord D moves to the A minor, which is the fifth, and then we move to the sixth, and then we move to the seventh, and then we come back as we loop it. Now, the other thing is qualities. You know, you have to understand chord qualities in the key signatures. This is really important, and that's all about diatonic harmony and how it functions. So you also have to double check and make sure that, okay, you know, the tonic chord here is D minor, and our chord progression is in the key of D minor. The next chord, A minor, that's a minor chord within the key. In the key of D natural minor, we have the fifth chord. It has to be minor. You know, if it's going to be natural minor, it's a minor chord. And then the sixth chord is major, seven is major, and that rounds out everything that's important in terms of basic diatonic harmony for our key. So if you're able to do that kind of work, you're way ahead of most people. You're probably 10% ahead of most people. If you don't know how to do some of that stuff, you got to look back on some of the material that I have online that's free on YouTube. I've got just hundreds and hundreds of videos on YouTube that explain things like this. Search my channels. You know, it's all on there. Now, if you want it in a real organized fashion rather than in a random fashion, go and check out the courses on my website. It's a little bit more organized that way. Sometimes, though, I also want to point out that these progressions can operate in reverse, and in those cases, the key center's tonic chord is going to show up at the end of the chord progression. So I've got another jam I want to show you like that, because that's kind of important too. 10-15% of the time, you're going to have a progression set up that way. And what happens is, we're going to keep this one also in the key of D minor. I've set up the chords to flow from the root of the key, into the root of the key rather than from the root of the key. And in this case, what's going to happen with this progression is we're going to move from a G minor, so that's the fourth chord of the key, we're going to move up to an A minor, which is, of course, the fifth chord, and then we're going to take it back to the tonic at the end of the progression. So our idea for this second jam is going to go like this. So again, that's a four chord into the five chord, and then here's the tonic chord, the root. Okay, so that kind of blows by step number one. You know, you got to understand this stuff. I know this lesson plan is really on soloing on one string, but this is the foundation of getting started with all soloing. You've got to understand this concept. Once we get past this, then we can move on to the next step, and that is going to be organizing the scale on a single string. In step two here, what we're going to look at doing is, you know, once you analyze and establish the key signature that your progression is in, now you know the tonality, you know what's going on, whether it's major or minor, all that stuff is taken care of. So all you have to do next is just lay the scale out on the guitar neck on the single string that you're going to focus on for your solo. And the tonic note is, of course, going to be kind of important how you want to set that up first. And in our key that we're sticking with through this lesson plan, which is D minor, you know, we want to focus on your D tone there. So I'm going to be using the third string. D tone's found on the third string at the 7th fret. Right, so that's my focal tone. And then I just want to lay the scale out, you know, moving along that string. I want to understand, of course, you know, the key signatures layout, which means that I have all natural tones in D minor except for the B, which is a B flat. So wherever the B occurs, it's got to be played as B flat. All right, so now if I'm coming from the open string, I mean, I could do it that way. I could go G open, go to the A, B flat, C, D, which is the tonic note, right? And then we can move forward in E and F. G, and then A, B flat if I want it up there. Keep focusing on the D. So I've laid out the scale, but maybe it might not be a bad idea to establish some kind of a practice routine drill, you know, just to fixate on that D tone and really get it hammered into my memory. I know it's there, and I want to memorize how all the other tones are laid out. So I have an example I want to show you. It's just, you know, going to run through like this. We'll go from the 7th to the 9th to the 10th to the 12th, 14th, back to the 12th, 10th, 9th, 7th. Take a breather. Drop down to the 5th fret, 3rd fret, 2nd fret, open. And we're coming back now. 2nd fret, 3rd fret, 5th fret. And then focus again a little more heavier on that D tone at 7th fret again. Now, I did frets as call-outs there, but let's do the actual tones themselves now. So here's a D, E, F, G, A, back to the G, F, E, D. Then go downwards here to the C tone, the B flat, A, G, A, B flat, and then C, back to the tonic note of D once again. So that's just like an exercise drill, you know, so focusing, really focusing on that 7th fret 3rd string. You could do other kinds of things, you know, it's the D minor key, and, you know, we're sort of focusing off that. We're lucky in one sense because we've got an open 4th string right underneath that 3rd string, which is open 4th string D. So we have, you know, some kind of modal sound that we can start pushing through on here. So that can be kind of fun. Now, something to think about, when I'm teaching this kind of stuff to my students, I'll often tell them, you know, you're in charge of exercises. Never forget that. You're in charge of the exercises that you do on guitar. So, you know, if you're doing a different key, just retune your 4th string in this case, you know, or the string below if you want to get a little bit of that modal sound going on. Naturally, right now, of course, because I'm in D minor, next lowest string normally is open 4th string D. You know, we're totally cool of doing this kind of modal thing along the neck. But if it wasn't, you know, if I was doing, wanted to mess around with C, well, just drop the sound of the 4th string from, you know, its natural state of being a D tone, drop it down to a C tone. Nothing much more than just, you know, you could even just hit a C at the 3rd fret of the 5th string, retune the guitar. If you're real fussy, you could grab your tuner and get it perfect. But, you know, there's always ways around this kind of stuff. And, you know, it's just good for your ear to have that map in the back of your mind, you know, of exactly what that tonality sounds like. So really interesting stuff that you can do, just getting used to the scale, laying it out, understanding its perspective across the guitar fingerboard, and that is step two. But, you know, we're really not done yet because we're not soloing yet, so let's go to step three. All right. This is the fun part. The part you've all been waiting for is just once you've sorted out your progression, you've established your key, you've learned the scale along the layout of the string, and you understand how to make some melodies just by monkeying around with the scale a little bit, having some fun. The next part is the creation part, you know, getting into building lines, understanding how to, you know, go through the parts and link up to chord changes and, you know, really have some, you know, good times with the idea of applying melody. Now, in the example that I want to run through here with you, because I did create an example melody for you to try, and then, you know, I really encourage you to just go off on your own and just, you know, have fun with this whole concept, you know, but I've composed a progression. It's really basic. I'm sticking with the whole theme of the lesson plan here, staying in D minor. So I got the D minor chord starting things off, and the next thing I'm going to do in the progression for the second measure is I'm going to blow through a C chord into a G minor, and I'm just going to come back on around to the top there again of the D minor once more. And then I'm going to just do a turnaround off of the B flat into the C. So the whole progression is going to be like this, D minor, and then C major to the G minor, back to the D minor again, and then B flat into C. Just pulling it back to the top on the D minor, rolling around, you know, for the tonic chord coming back. So that's the progression, and you can loop that, or you could create one of your own. I don't know, it's up to you, whatever you want to do. I'm just giving you sort of a ballpark idea here on how to approach all this. Now, I want to go through the example melody that I came up with, because sometimes, I don't know, in my years of teaching, I just find it's good to have examples that people could start with, kind of like springboard ideas, and you try these, and then you can go on to your own stuff. Now, the idea that I have, it's going to start on the D tone at the 7th fret of the 3rd string. And then what we're going to do is sustain that out for a beat and a half, and then we're going to move up the neck into the 10th fret, into the 12th with a hammer on there. And then we're going to drop down into the 9th fret. So we'll go 10, 12, and then back to the 10, and then have the 9th come in. And then we're going to do another hammer on there, 10 to 12, so that F back over to the G. Then we're going to do grace note slide upwards here into the A, so 12 going to 14 real quick there. Back down to the 12, back down to 10, slide again, grace note slide 12 to 14, back to the 12, sustain that for a moment, take it down to the 5th fret. So we're taking advantage of a large span of the fingerboard here. That's the beauty of the single string soloing. Very cool sounds can come from that. Now what we're going to do next is we're going to move more to the lower end of the neck here. I'm going to start off on 7th fret, jump to A here on 2nd fret, do a grace note slide from the B flat to the C, so 3rd fret, 5th fret, back to the B flat. And then I'm going to do a sort of a hammer-on double pull-off concept here with some 16th notes on the 2nd to 3rd frets, 2nd to 3rd, back to 2nd, into the open. And then grab the A tone into the G tone, 3rd string open to wrap that measure up. And then what we're going to do is jump up the neck into the 7th position. And I got a really fast idea here for you. It's a 32nd note pull-off concept. Off the 3rd string, we're going from 10 to 9 to 7. Real quick there. So then what happens after that, though, is we're going to move up into a 9th fret, 10th fret, back to the 9th, and then into the 7th. Just like that. So it's quick. You got to be really good on your pull-offs for that. I'm snapping with my 4th finger into my 3rd, and then the 3rd snaps over into the index. Put some good, you know, force into that. Really have it sustain. And then bring it over to the G tone, because the final chord we're playing there before we head back to the top of the progression is going to be a C major chord. Strong chord tone in that is a G, the perfect fifth inside that chord, and we're going to head towards that into the final note and sustain on it too. So there's our G tone, 10th fret, ripping up right into that 12th fret G right there and sustaining for two beats. So real quick movement on 3rd string there, 10, 9, 7, back through some of those tones. And then the fast move up into that high G there. All right, maybe I'll do the whole thing for you here to give you a good idea how it's all set up. All right, all the tabs for this are going to be on my Blogger page. You know, just go to the Blogspot link that you'll see on the screen right now. And, you know, just do a search for this lesson if you're watching this somewhere off in the future, and you'll find all the tabs and all the stuff that we went through on the progressions and the diagrams of the neck and everything so that you can work this out and have a really good time messing around with this key and then hopefully move over to a whole bunch of other keys, you know, and get this into some major tonality jams, you know, and it's really, you know, get it happening on your neck, because there's so much that this does for you. It really taps into what you're hearing in your mind, gets you going a little bit more with phrasing devices, because you can tell here, I'm doing a lot of slides, a lot of hammer-ons, pull-offs, you know, position shifting is going on. You know, it takes a little bit more technique to be able to play very laterally along the neck and do a lot of this horizontal work when you're functioning just on one guitar string. Well, you know, as you practice learning your scales, you'll find that almost every book and diagram method will focus on laying out the scale in a vertical fretboard position. And that's good. There's nothing wrong with that. That's how I learn my scales, and that's how I show all my students their scales on guitar. However, I do need to stress the value behind spreading the scale out more horizontally and spending time performing scales just along one string. And, you know, there's a value in also forcing yourself out of the common in position box shapes. It's going to help you develop solos and melodies played more along the neck. Plus, this whole system is really good for learning the scale's notes and the key signatures, and also, you know, new ways of phrasing melodic ideas, because there's ways that we phrase, you know, when we work very vertically, and then there's different things we do when we work more horizontal. And the final point that's really important here is going more horizontal along the neck. It helps your ear comprehend the sound of the scale structure much more linear, so you can play all kinds of unique phrases that you're hearing in your head. Well, hey, thanks for joining me. If you'd like to find out what you should learn next on guitar, take a look at the courses over on my website at creativeguitarstudio.com. My step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced courses are going to cover what you need to know, along with how to be able to move forward and become the best guitar player that you can be. I've worked on these courses for a long time. I started organizing them back in 1992 when I first graduated from Hollywood, California's Musicians Institute, and I feel that altogether these courses are the best guitar program that you're going to find. The courses will help you learn to identify what's required to get you up to that next level of guitar playing in a very organized way that just simply makes sense. So I look forward to helping you further at creativeguitarstudio.com. Until next time, if you liked the video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more, and we'll catch up with you again on the next video. Bye for now. When it comes to online guitar lessons, there's no place better than creativeguitarstudio.com. General membership to the site is always free, and paid memberships to access our step-by-step beginner, intermediate, and advanced guitar programs are offered in reasonable monthly and annual packages. Skype lessons are also available if you need more specific instruction one-on-one to discuss the finer details of your guitar playing. Sign up today at creativeguitarstudio.com. I've got 25 years experience teaching guitar and have written a well-organized step-by-step guitar course. Head over to my website at creativeguitarstudio.com and sign up for a free membership today. Join the thousands of members worldwide who have already enrolled. There's no need to try learning the guitar on your own. Let me help you become the best guitar player that you can be.